Hello everyone, dear students, today we shall discuss about a new chapter, that is deadlocks. So in this particular chapter, basically we want to study the deadlock problem, system model, deadlock characterization, and the different methods for handling deadlock, deadlock prevention, deadlock avoidance, deadlock detection, and the recovery from the deadlock. So first of all, let us understand the deadlock problem. In a multi-programming environment, several processes may compete for a finite number of resources. A process requests resources, and if the resources are not available at that time, the process enters a waiting state. Sometimes, a waiting process is never again able to change the state because the resources it has requested are held by the other waiting processes. So this particular situation is called as deadlock. It means there will be a set of block processes. The processes which are waiting for the resources will be blocked here. That is what a set of block processes, each holding resource. Every process will be holding some resource, and it is waiting to acquire a resource which is held by another process in the set. So this is a situation of deadlock. It means two or more processes are in the waiting state. They are holding some resources. They are already holding some resources, and they are waiting to acquire the resources which are held by other processes. So indefinitely, the processes will be in the waiting state, and the state of the process is never going to be changed. So this is called as a deadlock situation. Let us take one simple example. Assume that a computer system has two disk drives, and there are two processes, P1 and P2. And P1 and P2 is going to hold one disk drive, and each needs another one. It means, suppose that there are two disk drives. They can be named as disk 1, disk 2. And process P1 is holding disk 1, process P2 is holding disk 2, process P1 is holding disk 1, process P2 is holding disk 2, and process P1 is waiting for a disk 2 that is held by process P2, and process P2 is waiting for disk 1 that is held by process P1. So process P1 and P2 are waiting indefinitely to acquire the resources which are acquired by other one. So it is definitely causing deadlock. The processes P1 and P2 always, they are waiting. So their state will be always waiting state. They will never come out of the waiting state. So that causes deadlock in the system. Now let us understand the system model. We all know that a computer system will be having different resources. The resources basically are of two types. A resource can be either physical resource or it can be logical resource. The resources such as I/O devices like keyboard, printer, monitor, memory devices or memory space, CPU cycles, these are called as physical resources. And the resources such as files, semaphores, monitors, these are called as logical resources or software resources. So these resources which are existing in the system called as resource types. They are called as resource types, and they are named as R1, R2, R3, R4 and so on up to Rm. So R1 is basically resource 1, R2 is resource 2, resource 3 and so on up to resource M. It means a system will be having M number of resource types. There will be M number of resource types, so which are categorized into two: physical resources and logical resources. For example, the CPU can be taken as a resource type, so it can be named as R1. And each resource type Ri, has Wi instances. So there will be one type of resource and there will be number of copies of that particular resource. So that is called as instances. A resource type RI has WI instances. For example, if the system consists of two different CPUs, then the resource type CPU has two instances. They can be named like CPU 0 and CPU 1. The resource type is basically CPU and it has got two instances of CPU. So that is called as CPU 0 and CPU 1. And a process must request a resource before using it. Before a process can use the resource, it has to make the request to acquire the resource. And after using it, the resource must be released. It means before using resource, a process must make a request to acquire the resources. And after using it, the resources must be released. And a process may request as many as resources as it requires. But the number of resources request should not exceed the total number of available resources in the system. A process may request any number of resources, but it should not exceed the total number of resources available in the system. And each process utilizes resources like this. So basically there will be three operations performed during resource allocation, that is request, use, release. Request is basically a process is requesting for the resources to acquire. If the resources are available, then its request will be granted immediately. The requested resources will be allocated to that particular process. If the requested resource is not available, then the process has to wait. It will be put into waiting queue until those resources are available. Once the resources are available, then those resources can be allocated to the requested process. So that is called as request operation. The next one is use. So once the request is granted, it means if the requested resources are available, then it will be allocated to that particular process. Now that process can use the resources, and after using the resources, the process has to release the resources. So there will be three operations carried out here, that is request, use and release. Let us take one simple dead dot example. A computer system is having one printer. So this is particularly resource. It is called a physical resource. One printer and one DVD drive. So there are two resources a system is having, that is one printer and one DVD drive. And suppose that there are two processes, PI and PJ, and process PI holding resource DVD drive. So DVD drive has been allocated to process PI, and process PJ is holding the printer. The printer has been allocated to process PJ. So PI and PJ, they are holding already one resources. PI is holding DVD drive, PJ is holding printer. And if process PI requests the printer, so that is held by PJ. Process PI is already holding DVD drive, and PI is requesting for the printer, that is held by other process PJ. Similarly, process PJ is holding printer and is requesting for DVD drive, that is held by process PI. So in this case, both process PI and PJ will be in the waiting state. It means process PI is waiting for the printer, which is held by PJ. So indefinitely process PI will be waiting. It never knows when PJ is going to release it. So similarly, process PJ is waiting for the DVD drive resource, which is held by process PI. So process PJ is also indefinitely waiting. So it means in this particular system, both processes PI and PJ are indefinitely waiting. So that causes deadlock in the system. Now the next topic is deadlock characterization. So there are some necessary conditions. So these are called as deadlock necessary conditions. Basically there are four different necessary conditions. To deadlock to happen, so all these four conditions must be satisfied simultaneously. It means deadlock can arise if four necessary conditions hold simultaneously. If all the four conditions satisfied simultaneously, then definitely there is a possibility of deadlock. Hence, these are called as deadlock's necessary conditions. And all four conditions must be satisfied simultaneously, then there is a possibility of deadlock. The deadlock may occur in the system if all the conditions are hold. The first condition is mutual exclusion. It means only one process at a time can use a resource. For example, there is some common resource and there are number of processes which are trying to access a resource simultaneously. In this case, only one process is allowed to use that particular resource, and all other processes which are requesting to acquire that resource will be in the waiting state. So indefinitely the other processes are waiting for the resource to be released by the first process. So this particular condition, if it is satisfied, definitely there is a possibility of deadlock, because the number of processes are in the waiting state. So indefinitely those processes might be waiting, so that may lead to deadlock. The second condition is hold and wait. A process already holding at least one resource and is waiting to acquire the additional resources held by other processes. So that is called as hold and wait. A process is basically holding at least one resource and it is waiting to acquire some other resources which is held by other processes. It means the process is in the waiting state. How long it will be waiting, we never know. So the hold and wait definitely may be causing the deadlock. The next condition is no preemption. A resource can be released only voluntarily by the process holding it after that process has completed its task. It means if a particular resource is allocated to a process, so it can, that process can hold that particular resource until it has completed its task. It means that process will not be preempted in between. So that process can hold the resource until its entire task is completed. It means the other processes which are trying to use that resource or acquire that resource will be indefinitely waiting. They will be blocked. So the no preemption condition also causing the deadlock. The next condition and the last condition is circular wait. Assume that there exists a set of processes which can be denoted as P0, P1 and so on up to Pn in the system of the waiting processes, such that process P0 is waiting for a resource that is held by P1. Process P0 is waiting for a particular resource which is held by the next process P1. So similarly, process P1 is waiting for the resource that is held by P2. Similarly, process P2 will be waiting for the resource that is held by the next process P3, and so on. Process Pn-1 is waiting for the resource that is held by Pn, and Pn is the last process. Pn is waiting for the resource that is held by P0. So definitely there is a circular wait here. One process is waiting for the next process to release the resource. So all the processes are in the waiting state. So that is called a circular wait. If all these conditions holds good or satisfied, definitely the system may enter into deadlock. Now let us move on to the next topic, resource allocation graph. As we learned that system will be having different resources and the resources will be allocated to the different processes. And the resource allocation to the processes can be graphically represented. So that is called as resource allocation graph. We know that a graph is made up of a set of vertices and edges. So similarly, a resource allocation graph is made up of a set of vertices V and a set of edges E. So the vertex set V is partitioned into two types. So that is P and R. So there are two different types in V. The first one P it is having a set of processes P1, P2, P3 and so on up to PN. So there will be n number of active processes. So that is indicated as set P here. Okay. The next one R, it is a set consisting of all the resource types in the system. We already learned that the resources that are in the system called as resource types, they are indicated like R1, R2, R3, so on up to Rm. So R is a set that is having the different resources. And this particular resource allocation graph will be having two kinds of edges. You know that vertices are nothing but basically processes and the resource types. So they are the vertices in the resource allocation graph. And what are the edges in the graph? There are two kinds of edges. The first one, request edge. We know that. We already learned that. A process may request for a particular resource type. So that is indicated by a directed edge. It is basically a directed graph having the directed edges. And one of the edges is called as a request edge. It will be a directed edge from process PI to RJ. Process PI will be connected to RJ through this particular edge. It means process PI is requesting for resource type RJ. And this particular resource type RJ will be having the number of instances of the resources. So that we already studied. So another kind of edge that we use in the resource allocation graph here is assignment edge. It is basically a directed edge. It is used to indicate resource allocation. It means directed edge from resource type RJ to PI. So there is an directed edge from resource type RJ to PI. It indicates an instance of resource RJ will be allocated to PI. It has been assigned to PI. It is called as assignment edge. Now, let us see what are the entities or what are the symbols we use in the resource allocation graph. The first one is process. The process in the resource allocation graph is indicated as a circle. The second one, resource type. So as we already learned at the beginning, the resource types may be containing the number of instances. For example, a particular resource type can be indicated like this. It is a square box. It is named as resource type RJ. And the resource type will be having the different instances. In this particular diagram, so there will be four instances of the resource type RJ. So there are four copies of this particular resource type. So it is indicated like this. So basically, a dot within this particular box is indicating an instance of the resource type. And process PI is connected to resource RJ. It means process PI is requesting for resource RJ. Now, the next one, this particular diagram indicates an instance of resource RJ. See, a particular dot from resource RJ is indicating an instance of resource RJ will be allocated to process PI. So, there is a directed edge from this particular resource instance to process PI. Process PI is allocated with an instance of resource RJ. Now let us take one example of a resource allocation graph. So there are three sets exist here, P, R, E. P is basically set of processes. So there are three processes, P1, P2, P3. In the resource allocation graph, we learned that already processes are indicated through circle, small circle. So there are three processes. Let us indicate three processes like this. Process P1, P2, P3 using circle. And resources. How many resources? There is a resource set here. It is having four resource types. R1, R2, R3, R4. And resource types are indicated as a rectangle. It's a small rectangle. So the resource R1, resource R2, resource R3 and resource R4, like this there are four different resources. The next one is set E. E is basically set of edges. It is consisting of two kinds of edges. One is a request edge, second one is assignment edge. If a process is requesting for a particular resource type, there will be an edge from that process to resource instance or resource type. Assignment is basically allocating an instance of a resource type to process. It will be an edge from a resource type to process. So there are four resources and every resource will be having the different instances. For example, there is one instance of resource type R1. Resource type R1 will be having only one copy. There is only one instance of resource type R1. So that is indicated like a small solid circle. There is a small dot with the resource R1. It indicates resource R1 will be having a single instance of that particular resource type. And the resource R2 will be having how many instances? There will be two instances of resource type R2. There are two copies of resource R2. So that is indicated as two dots in this particular resource R2. So similarly, resource R3 will be having only one instance. So there is only one copy of resource R3 that is indicated as a single dot in this particular box. And there are three different instances of resource type R4. For resource type R4, there will be three different copies or three instances of resource R4 that is indicated like three dots in this particular box for R4. Now let us understand what is the process state. So that is shown in this particular set E. Process P1 is holding an instance of resource R2. Process P1 will be holding an instance of resource type R2. An instance of resource type R2 is allocated to process P1. So that is indicated like this. Process P1 is holding an instance of resource R2. So there is an assignment edge we can observe here. Process P1 is holding an instance of resource type R2. So that is, this particular instance of resource type R2 is allocated to process P1. So this edge is called as assignment edge. And process P1 is waiting for an instance of resource type R1. It means process 1 has requested an instance of resource R1. Here, so this particular edge is indicating what? Request edge. Process P1 is requesting for an instance of resource R1. So this is what it is shown here. The next one, process P2 is holding an instance of resource R1. Process P2 is holding an instance of resource R1. See, R1 is having the single instance, so that is being allocated to process P2. So we will find an assignment edge here from resource type R1 to process P2. And process P2 is waiting for instance of R3. Process P2, he has requested an instance of R3. So there is a request edge shown from process P2 resource R3. Next one, process P3 is holding an instance of R3. Process P3 is holding an instance of resource R3. So there is an assignment edge shown here from resource R3 to process P3, and no resources from, there is no allocation done from the resource type R4. In R4 there are three different instances of the resource type R4. They are not allocated to any of the processes, and no process has made request to acquire these particular resource types. So this is called as a resource allocation graph. So in this particular graph, process P1 has acquired an instance of resource R2. An instance of resource R2 has been allocated to process P1. At the same time, process P1 is waiting for an instance of resource R1. So that is held by process P2. And process P2 has acquired an instance of resource type R2. At the same time, process P2 is waiting for an instance of resource R3 that is held by process P3. And process P3 is not waiting for any of the resources. Present, it is holding one instance of resource R3. Here in this particular graph, if the graph contains no cycle, then it indicates no process in the system is deadlocked. If the graph doesn't contain any of the cycle, there is no question of deadlock. So this particular graph we don't find any of the cycle. So let us take one example. It begins here, we go here, but there is no path to reach back. Hence, there are no cycles present in the particular graph. It means there is no question of deadlock in the system. If the graph contains cycle, then a deadlock may exist or deadlock may occur. Now let us take a resource allocation graph with a deadlock. It's the same diagram that we have taken from the previous slide, but there is one additional thing added here. Let us look at process P1. Process P1 has acquired an instance of resource R2 and it is waiting for and resource from R1, and which is held by process P2, and process P2 has acquired a resource from R2 and it is waiting for an instance of resource from resource type R3, which is held by process P3. Process P3 has acquired a resource instance from R3 and it is requesting for a resource instance from R2. So if you look at this particular diagram, all the processes are waiting indefinitely. Process P1 is waiting for resource instance R1, which is held by P2. So process P1 will be indefinitely waiting because it never knows when that resource will be released by P2. So similarly, P2 is holding an instance of resource R2 and it is waiting for the resource instance of R3, which is held by P3. So process P2 is indefinitely waiting until process P3 releases. It never knows when P3 is going to release this particular resource. So similarly, P3 is requesting for the resource instances from resource type R2. From the R2, both the instances have been allocated to P1 and P2. So process P3 is indefinitely waiting for the resource instances to be released by either process P1 and P2. P3 never knows when P1 and P2 are going to release these two resources. It means definitely there is a possibility of deadlock. So if you look at this particular diagram, there are two cycles present here, like P1 R1, P2 R3, P3 R2 P1. So this is one cycle. The other cycle is P2 R3, P3 R2 P2. So this particular resource allocation graph having two cycles. So definitely there is a deadlock exists here. So all the processes are in the waiting state. Not a single process is currently executing. So one process is waiting for another process to release the resource. So there will be infinite or indefinite waiting for all the processes that is causing deadlock. Now let us move on to the another example. It is a graph having a cycle, but there is no deadlock here. It means that a cycle in the resource allocation graph doesn't guarantee the deadlock. If you look at this particular example, process P1 has acquired an instance of resource type R2 and it is waiting for the resource from R1, which is acquired by P2 and P3. And process P2 has acquired an instance of resource R1 and it has not made any request to other resources. Process P3 has acquired an instance of resource R1 and it is waiting for an instance from resource R2 that is allocated to process P1 and P4. So in this particular case, even though there is a cycle present here from P1, R1, P3, R2, P1, there is a cycle present here, still there is no possibility of deadlock, because whenever process P2 and P4 has not made any request for the resources. Suppose that whenever P4 releases particular instance of resource at some point of time, now an instance of resource R2 is definitely available to P3. So process P3 will come out of waiting and it will acquire instance of resource R2 whenever P4 releases particular resource. So like this, the waiting will be removed. Hence, there is no possibility of deadlock here. Now let us understand some basic facts of graph now. If graph contains no cycle, then there is no question of deadlock. If graph contains a cycle, if only one instance per resource type, then there is a deadlock. See, every resource type has only one instance of the only one instance, then definitely there is a deadlock and graph containing cycle. If there are several instances per resource type, every resource type will be having the number of instances. We cannot deny that there is no deadlock, but definitely there is a possibility of deadlock since there is a cycle in the graph. Now let us see what are the different methods for handling the deadlock. Now we understood what is deadlock, how deadlock arises, what are the different necessary conditions to occur deadlock or to deadlock to happen, and how to represent deadlock using resource allocation graph. Now we shall understand what are the different methods for handling deadlock. So there are three different ways to handle the deadlock. First one, simply ensure that the system will never enter a deadlock state. So we'll have to develop a mechanism to ensure that the computer system will be never enter into a deadlock state. Second one, allow the system to enter the deadlock state, then try to recover from the deadlock. So another method is, if there is a possibility of deadlock, let us allow the system to enter the deadlock state, then later on we should try to recover from the deadlock. So that is called as deadlock recovery. The system has already entered into the deadlock, and using some mechanism, let us try to recover from the deadlock. Then the third one, ignore the problem of the deadlock and pretend that deadlock is never going to occur in the system. Let us ignore the deadlock problem completely, and let us pretend that the deadlock problem is never going to occur in the system. So this particular mechanism has been adopted by the operating systems including Unix and Windows. Now let us look at deadlock prevention. So before that, we already learned four necessary conditions for deadlock, that is mutual exclusion, hold and wait, circular wait, and the next one is resource preemption. There are four: mutual exclusion, hold and wait, no preemption, circular wait. So these are the necessary conditions for the deadlock to occur. Now how to prevent the deadlock to occur? So this is one of the best method to avoid the deadlock. So to prevent deadlock from occurring in the system, just we'll have to ensure that these four conditions are not satisfied. Just we'll have to make sure that these necessary conditions are not holds good or satisfied. The first necessary condition for the deadlock to occur is mutual exclusion. It means a process can enter into, or it can hold a resource, and all other processes which are trying to access that particular resource should be waiting. It means only one process at a time can use the resource, and if any other process requests that resource, the requesting resource for the process must be delayed until the resource has been released. So that is mutual exclusion condition. So this condition should not be satisfied for deadlock prevention. It means mutual exclusion is not required for shareable resources. If the resources are not shareable, then only mutual exclusion can be used. It means for the non-shareable resources. For example, if you take a printer. Printer is non-shareable. It means only one process can use the printer at a time. So in this case, we can go for mutual exclusion. Let only one process to use printer. So that is a non-shareable resource, and all other processes which are trying to use that printer should be suspended. They must be waiting. So that is not mutual exclusion. Only one process is allowed to use that non-shareable resource at a particular point of time. but we should not allocate mutual exclusion, and it is not required for shareable resource. For example, if it is read-only file, what is the read-only file? There is a file and the processes can only read its content. The processes cannot make any modifications to the file. It is only reading purpose. It is called as read-only file. It means the number of processes which are trying to read that particular file should be allowed simultaneously. It means the reading process should not be in the waiting state. All the reading processes should be allowed to read the contents of the file simultaneously. It means mutual exclusion is not required for the shareable resources like read-only files. In this case, the waiting of the process for the resources can be avoided. It means mutual exclusion will not be applied for the shareable resources. Like this, if the mutual exclusion is avoided, definitely a deadlock can be prevented. The next condition is hold and wait. So this is second necessary condition for the deadlock. It should not be satisfied. What is hold and wait? The process is holding a resource and it is waiting for for the other resource which is held by some other process. So there is a hold and wait happening and it should not be satisfied. There must be guarantee that whenever a process requests a resource, it does not hold any of the resources. What is the solution? The hold and wait cannot be happening at the same time. A process holding some resource at the same time it is waiting for the other resource which held by some other process. It should not happen. It means whenever a process makes a request for a particular resource, the waiting should be avoided. How? It means it does not hold any of the resources. Either it has to hold the resource or it has to acquire the resource. Hold and wait, it should not do it at the same time. Next point, require process to request and be allocated all its resources before it begins execution. It means we cannot start the execution of the process until all the required resources are available. Or allow the process to request resources only when the process has none. Let us allow the process to request resources only when no other process is holding those resources. So like this we can avoid hold and wait. But this particular solution causing low resource utilization. Here process execution will not be started until all the required resources are available. Or we cannot allow the process to request the resources until the required resources are available. It means the process execution will be delayed until the required resources are available in the system. That may cause low resource utilization. And also there is a starvation possible. It means indefinite waiting. It means process is ready to execute but it cannot be executed until the resources are made available to it. That may cause starvation problem. The third condition is no preemption. It means if a resource is allocated to a particular process, that process should not be preempted in between. We should allow that process to complete the task, and after the completion of the task, then only it can use the resource. But to prevent the deadlock, so the resources must be preempted. So no preemption should not be satisfied. If a process that is holding some resource requests another resource that cannot be immediately allocated to it, then all the resources currently being held are released. It means if a process is already holding some resources and it is trying to acquire some other resources which are held by some other process, so that process is in the waiting state. In this case, what we can do is we should tell that the process to release all the resources which are it is currently holding. The second point, preempted resources. It is called as resource preemption. we'll tell the process to release the resources. It is called as process preemption. The preempted resources are added to the list of resources for which the process is waiting. The resources which are released by the process will be added to the list of resources. The third point, process will be restarted only when it can regain its old resources as well as the new ones that it is requesting. A process is suspended from the execution because the requested resources are not available and the already allocated resources will be free, and that process will not be restarted until it will regain all its old resources and also the new resources which are requested. Until that process cannot be restarted. In this case, the no preemption condition can be avoided. The next one is circular wait. One process is waiting for the resource which is held by its next process. So there will be circular waiting happening here. So that may cause a deadlock. To prevent the deadlock, we need to avoid circular waiting. So simply we need to impose a total ordering of the resource types, and acquire that each process request resources in an increasing order of the enumeration. So let us arrange the resources in some order, and resource allocation for the different processes will be made in the increasing order. So like this we can avoid the circular wait. So this is the end of deadlock part 1. Thank you.